نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي رب زدني علما اللهم فقهنا في الدين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما آمين ثم آمين. Today is the first lecture of our subject, Sciences of the Quran, that is Uloom al-Quran. And we will be having a session of 1 hour together. So the first question that arises is, what is Uloom al-Quran? Is it the biology, physics and chemistry in the Quran? Because you're going to the through the tafsir of the Quran and you have studied a lot of phenomenon related to the cloud formation or how the earth came into, or the universe came into being through the Big Bang, or all of these different concepts have been explained in the Quran. And the first thing that comes into our mind is that when we talk about sciences of the Quran, does it mean all of these sciences that we think? Well, the answer is no. Sciences of the Quran or Uloom al-Quran is basically comprising the branches of knowledge that are needed to understand the Quran. For instance, the recitation, the history of the Quran, understanding of the Quran, that is the tafsir, and how are we supposed to implement the Quran. So the tajweed, that's a separate subject. You have been studying the tajweed, right? That is the ways to recite. What is the proper way to recite? And there's not just one way to recite. There are multiple ways that we're going to study in the Uloom al-Quran subject. We're going to study about the Sabah Qiraat. The Tajweed subject that you are studying right now, that is part of the Uloom al-Quran. That is part of the Uloom al-Quran. That is one chapter of the Uloom al-Quran, that how the Tajweed is done, how is the Quran recited. Then another aspect in the Uloom al-Quran is the history of the Quran. How was it revealed? What is wahi? How was it compiled? How was it recorded or preserved? What is the script? What are the different ways in which the Quran was written down? You will be studying the different type of scripts and how the Quran initially was written without any dots, without any harakas, and why did the haraka came into being in the first place. So inshallah ta'ala, we'll be studying all of that also in this subject. Another aspect, another area, another chapter in this subject is understanding of the Quran. So the concept of revelation, the asbab al-nazul, why was an ayah, why was a surah revealed, what was the reason for it? And then the time period, was it Makkan or what was it Madani? So we are going to study all of that. Now what are the Makkan surahs? What are the Makkan ayahs? Why are they called the Makkan ayahs? What are the Madani surahs? And then the abrogation. This is also in a very important area in Uloom al-Quran. There were certain verses that were removed. Why were they removed? What was the reason? Plus, who can do tafsir and how is the tafsir done? So all of these aspects we're going to understand. Then there's the miraculous nature of the Quran. And this comes in the implementation phase, the ijaz al-Quran, how the Quran makes us ajiz. What are the miracles that are contained in the Quran, and how can we prove all of these miraculous, areas of the Quran, how they impact the heart, how they make us ajiz. The challenge to recreate its likes. There was a challenge given in the Quran. You must have studied about that in Surah Al-Baqarah. This is a valid challenge that was there. And this is also part of the miraculous nature of the Quran, that no one could ever, till this day, hundreds and hundreds of years have passed, but no one has been able to recreate the likes. Then the linguistic miracle, the miracle in the language of the Quran. This is also a chapter that inshallah ta'ala we're going to do in Uloom al-Quran. Miracle in the content. Whatever is in the Quran, the subject matter, the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, all that is you know, the miracle that is involved, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be studying that miracle in the recitation. How is it a miracle? So inshallah ta'ala, all of these areas we're going to study. But the first thing we have to clear out, because a lot of people must be thinking, you must be thinking that we're doing so many subjects, why another subject? You know, and this is a very hefty subject. If you hold the book in your hand, it's a very heavy, you know, big book. And any one of you might be questioning that we're studying tafsir and tajweed and fiqh, all of these different subjects. Why another subject? So what is the importance and what is the reason why we're studying Ulum al-Quran? The first thing is to appreciate this treasure so we can rejoice and be proud of our book. That the thing that we hold in our hands is not an ordinary book, it's a treasure. The second is to help us increase our knowledge and realize how ignorant we are. Sometimes you would see people who are just, you know, they have a little bit of know-how in how to recite the Quran, and they start thinking that they're big scholars of, you know, grand scholars of Quran. Some people, they, you know, start teaching Quran and they start thinking that, you know, oh, we know everything about Quran. But Ulum al-Quran teaches us to be humble and gives us this insight that there's so little that we know, and we learn about the bigger picture that is there to know. And as Muslims, we can defend our religion at the intellectual front against attacks. You know today that most of the atheists and the people who have left religion, there are scientists, they have a lot of knowledge. And you, if you interact with them, a lot of people, you know, they lose their iman because they don't have answers. They don't know what to do. And their iman isn't strong enough. Why isn't it strong enough? Because they don't have the solid knowledge, and the knowledge hasn't gone into the hearts, and the miraculous nature of the Quran has not affected them. So, you know, this is very necessary for us. This is a must for every person, especially the youth who interact with such people in universities and colleges and online, to have this knowledge of Ulum al-Quran. And then again, this is going to increase our iman. It's going to have a booster. And we are, inshallah ta'ala, going to experience this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah As-Saf, As-Qad, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَذَّكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. So this is a book that we have sent down upon him. So أَنزَلْنَاهُ, we have sent it down, إِلَيْكَ, towards you, towards the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مُبَارَكٌ. It is full of barakah. Why? لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. So that you ponder upon the ayat, the verses of the Quran. You think about them. You go deep down into the meanings. وَلِيَذَّكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And the intelligent ones, the people of intellect, they get reminders, they get reminded, and they learn lessons from this, right? So this is the reason given in the Quran as to why we have to study Ulum al-Quran. So let's start with the history of the sciences of the Quran. When did it start? When this area of knowledge start? So this started right from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it used to happen that the companions would ask questions about the Quran to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would answer them. They would ask questions related to the ayat of the Quran, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to reply to them. Now, one of such questions was regarding the ayah in Surah Al-An'am. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانُهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. So those people who have faith, they don't mix or muddle their iman with zulm. So the Sahaba started asking that who amongst us does not do injustice? Zulm. Every one of us is doing zulm, because we can never be completely just, you know, because only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied that injustice referred here means shirk, that's this associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was an explanation of this ayah And this fact that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained this, this is part of the Ulum al-Quran. Another, very famous incident was when Umar radiallahu heard a sahabi doing a different recitation once, and he got very angry. And you know how Umar radiallahu used to be. And he was, he grabbed that sahabi by the neck and he said, how dare you change the recitation of the Quran? And he said, the sahabi replied that this is how the Prophet taught me to recite. So they both went to the Prophet and Prophet made both of them, Umar radiallahu and that sahabi, recite those ayahs. And Prophet said to both of them that you both are correct. This is correct and that is correct. So this was, the differences in the qiraat that were present at the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that were present and that were taught by the Prophet sallallahu, different sahaba were, taught differently. And this also is a part of the sciences of the Quran. Now, at the time of the passing away of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Umar radiallahu was devastated. All the Sahaba were devastated and they were crying and they were just heartbroken that their beloved Prophet had passed away. But Umar radiallahu, the anger that he had, he took his sword out and he said that whoever is going to say that Prophet has passed away, he has died, I am going to chop off his head. And at that time, Abu Bakr radiallahu, he went to the minbar, he went to the, to Masjid al-Nabawi, and he recited these ayahs. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. This is from Ali Imran. And in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling the mu'mineen that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is just a rasul. And if he dies, are you going to just step back and are you going to start disbelieving? So for Umar radiallahu, this was such a big shock. And he said it was as if it's the first time I heard those ayahs. And he said, it seems that this is the first time that these ayahs were revealed. So you see that these ayahs were used by Abu Bakr radiallahu. And how they were revealed and why they were revealed, all of this ilm, this is part of the Ulumul Quran. Now, who were the companions who were famous for their knowledge of the Quran and for this subject? The four khulafa, definitely. And then Abdullah ibn Masood, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ubay ibn Ka'b, Sayyid bin Thabit, Abu Musa al-Ashari, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Aisha ibn Abi Bakr. So all of these sahaba, they were experts in the subject of Ulum al-Quran. They specialized in it. One of these sahaba, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was the cousin of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for him when he was only 13 years old. He was very small. And the dua of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for him was, Allahumma faqihu fi deen wa allimhu ta'wil. So give him fiqh of the deen and teach him the ta'wil. Teach him how the Quran is interpreted. So this, when Prophet ﷺ did a dua for Abdullah ibn Abbas, that means that he could understand, he could really know what that ayah actually means. Then it was Abdullah ibn Masood, and he says about himself that I memorized over 70 surahs directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then there was Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Abdullah ibn Masood said that I swear by Allah, beside whom there is no other God, there is no surah in the Quran except that I know where it was revealed, and there is not a single verse in the Quran except that I know the reason behind its revelation. If there were any person that knew more about the Quran than I did, and it was possible for me to reach him, I would ride on my camel towards him to get this knowledge. So this was how anxious the Sahaba were to learn about the meanings of the Quran. And Ibn Masood, this is how expert he was and how specialized he was in the tafsir of the Quran. Then there was Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he told his students, ask me, for I swear by Allah, there is nothing that you will ask me except that I will answer you. Ask me concerning the book of Allah, for I swear by Allah, there is not a single verse in the Quran except that I know whether it was revealed at night or during the day or on a mountain or on a plain. So the place of Nuzul, Ali ibn Abi Talib is telling that he knew where it was revealed, why it was revealed. So these are the companions who were specialized in Ulum al-Quran. They knew about them through and through, and they taught the Tabi'een about it. Then is the history of the sciences of the Quran. Let's start with the history now. The first and the most important of the topics to be written was on tafsir, the area of the Ulum al-Quran that was, put down on paper and that was written down was tafsir. For example, each of the following scholars wrote a tafsir of the Quran composed of statements from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and companions. So Sufyan al-Thawri, he's a very, very famous person. He has written amazing books. Then Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Waqi ibn al-Jarrah, and Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj. So all these people, they have written books on tafsir. They have done monumental work. So following his predecessor's footsteps, Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabri wrote a monumental Jami al-Bayan, Al-Ta'wil al-Qur'an. This is a book on tafsir. So this is also a book that you will say that it is a book on Ulum al-Qur'an. Okay, so because this is a book on tafsir. And all of the later scholars benefit from, till today, they benefit from this book. Other earlier tafsirs were written by Abu Bakr ibn Mundhiran Naysaburi and Ibn Abi Hatim, Ibn Hibban, and Al-Hakim, and Ibn Mardawa. All of these tafsirs were based on reports from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions and successors, and include the chains of narration, the isnad. You know that the chain of narration that, you know, one, Taba Tabi'i has narrated from the Tabi, who has narrated from the Sahabi, who has narrated the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this chain is called the isnad, and all of these are reported and these are written down in tafsir books, all the different ahadith about the different ayahs also. Okay, so these all were part of the tafsirs. After the books of tafsirs followed a plethora of books on other sciences of the Quran. So now you know that the first of the books that were written regarding the Ulum al-Quran were the tafsir books. And then regarding different areas of Ulum al-Quran, loads and loads of other books were written by amazing scholars. So Ali al-Madani, the teacher of Imam al-Bukhari, wrote a book on Asbab al-Nuzul. Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Salama wrote two books, one on sciences of Qira'at, which was one of the first of its kind. So this was the first book that was written on the topic, and one on abrogation in the Quran, the Nasikh wal Mansukh. So this is a chapter we're going to do at the end of the course, inshallah. Ibn Qutayba wrote a book on rare words in the Quran, Mushkil al-Quran. This is the name of the book, Mushkil al-Quran. And Abu Ishaq al-Jazzaz, the judge, wrote a grammatical analysis of the Quran, Irab al-Quran. This is the name of the book, Irab al-Quran, right? And then it was Ibn Darstawa, composed a tract on the miraculous nature of the Quran, Ijaz al-Quran. So the reason why I am telling you the names of the books and the authors of the books is that you should know that this subject has been, worked upon since ages. And a lot of scholars have worked very hard to bring about great works on this subject, on the different areas of this subject, okay? So different books that are mentioned here are Gharib al-Quran, Ijaz al-Quran, and then the author of the Sunan, Imam al-Nisa'i, he has also written a book, Fadail al-Quran, right? So another book is Asbab al-Nuzul. So all of these books are on the topic of Ulum al-Quran, and many, many more books are there in the libraries for you to read, for you to understand what the sciences of the Quran mean. And it must also be mentioned that in addition to these books, many of the books of Hadith and Sahih of al-Bukhari and Muslim include sections on various topics of Ulum al-Quran. For example, most of the books of the Sunnah have chapters on the tafsir of the Quran, the benefits of reciting the Quran, the history of the compilations, and other topics also. So you would find Ulum al-Quran topics in Bukhari and Muslim also, inshallah, when you study them. Okay, so as far as the more of such works and the kinds are concerned, one of the big, huge names that you're going to listen on and all is Badruddin al-Zarqashi. So Zarqashi has come up with this amazing book, Al-Burhahim fi Ulum al-Quran. This is actually a big book on this whole subject. The name Ulum al-Quran arises here. Then Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. He has written a book called Al-Itqan fi Ulum al-Quran. This is also a very monumental work that is present there. And some of the great books of this era are you know, given here. You can read about them. But today, there are simpler versions of Ulum al-Quran books. And one of the first books written in the today's time, the simple versions, and in English, they're Ahmed Wandefer's book, Ulum al-Quran, An Introduction to Sciences of the Quran. And there's one book by Amina Bilal Phillips. And then this book that you're going to study in this subject is the book written by Sheikh Yasir Qadhi. That is the Sciences of the Quran, Introduction to the Sciences of the Quran. These books are toned down, easier versions of these huge monumental books, so that you can understand them, and they're not too heavy for you, because this is just the first step in understanding the Quran. Let's come to the dive into the first of the lessons now. And the first of the topics, that is the linguistic meaning of the word Quran. What does the Quran mean? This is the first chapter. This is the first topic in this subject. And so there are different meanings of the word Quran, right? And there are different opinions by different people concerning the linguistic meaning of the word Quran. So the most popular opinion, and the opinion held by At-Tabari, is that the word Quran is derived from qara'a, which means to read or to recite. Quran would then be the verbal noun master of qara'a, and thus translates as the recitation, the reading. So Allah says in reference to the Quran, wa Quranan faraqnahu, and it is the Quran which we have divided into parts. So this is the recitation, the reading, right? Because it is recited, it is read. And in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inna alayna jam'ahu wa qur'ana, fa idha qara'nahu fattabi' qur'ana. And it is for us to collect it and to recite it. When we have recited it, then follow its recitation, right? So here you can understand the reason why Quran is called, why the Quran is called Quran, right? The name Quran, Imam Shafi says, it's a proper noun, a name given to the book of Allah, not derived from any word, just like Torah and Injil. So since there are different opinions, Imam Shafi, according to him, there is no root word of Quran. Rather, it is a name given to the Quran, just like Torah and Injil. The names given to Torah and Injil, they're the names of the book. That is the same thing. In other opinions, Al-Quran is derived from three root words. Qarana, Qara'a, and another is Qara'a. The third opinion is Qara'in, and another is Qar. So let's just check it out what these means. The first is Qarana, to compile, to put together. to join, to associate, like Hajj Quran. What is Hajj Quran? If you have studied the book of Hajj, so Hajj Quran means that you join the Umrah with the Hajj. You you have the niyyah and you do the Hajj, and you do not remove your ihram. You have the same ihram and you do Umrah and then Hajj, right? So this is called Quran. Why? Because you join both of them. So to compile and put together verses, aid and help one another, they are joined together to form a surah, and the surahs are put together to form the Quran. So that is why one of the opinions is that the Quran is known as the Quran. Then the other is qara'a, that means, which means recited, to recite, recitation. We have done this already. So over the history from the first revelation, the Quran has been recited. Rather than being written down, it was recited. So at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if the Sahaba were talking about the Quran, they would not think that it is a book. Why? Because not it wasn't in the form of a book. They couldn't see it in the form of a book. Everyone was reciting it. They were learning it by heart, right? So another meaning is the recitation. So Quran is from qara'in, means to resemble, to be similar to something, qara'in, right? People give qara'in as to give similarity of something with another. So the surahs resemble each other in beauty and prose, in meaning. So some people, according to some opinions, Quran is from qara'in. Fourth opinion is that Quran is from qar, means to combine. So it combines stories, commands, promises, and punishments. That is why it is called Quran. So this is a definition of the Quran that you have to memorize in your book. You will find it on page number 25. You have to learn this by heart. And there are different parts to this definition that we're going to understand and break up. But the main definition is the Arabic speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Know that this speech, what is the Quran? It is the Arabic speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he revealed to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in wording and in meaning, which has been preserved in the Mus'hafs, and it has reached us by numerous transmissions. And it is a challenge to mankind to produce something similar to it. So this is the definition. I am going to repeat it again. The Arabic speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he revealed to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in wording and in meaning, which has been preserved in the Mus'hafs, and it has reached us by numerous transmissions, and it is a challenge to mankind to produce something similar to it. Now, the statement in the definition that the Quran is the Arabic speech of Allah, right? This implies that Quran is in the Arabic language. This therefore implies that a translation of the Quran into any other language cannot be considered the Quran. If you have a Mus'haf, if you have a book and the English translation of the Quran is written in it and there is no Arabic text, you're not going to call it the Quran. You can call it the translation of the Quran, the meaning of the Quran, but you cannot call it the Quran because the Quran has to be in Arabic. Imam Al-Zarqashi said, know that the Quran has been revealed in the language of the Arabs. Therefore, it is impossible to recite it in any other language. It is not permissible to recite the Quran. So if you have the English translation of this, of the Quran with you, you're not gonna start doing tilawat of that English translation or Urdu translation or any other language, okay? So there are 11 references in the Quran that it is in Arabic language. Amongst them, these are the verses, وَهَذَا لِسَانٌ عَرَبِيٌّ مُبِينٌ, and this Quran is in clear Arabic tongue. And another place, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا, verily we have revealed this as Arabic Quran. Right? وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا, again, that we have revealed to you, towards you, the Quran that is in Arabic. Now, another question arises, is the translation of the Quran the Quran. So the answer is only the Arabic is the Quran. Translation is not the Quran. So for Christians, the Bible in English translation is thought to be the actual Bible. They think that this is the actual Bible, whereas Jesus never spoke Greek, he never spoke Latin, Spanish, or any other form of English. So you see, the actual Bible was not in English, and it was not in any of the languages that are present today that people read, right? So in every word originally, is every word originally from Arabic? This question arises. In the Quran, is every word originally from Arabic? So what do you think? Yes or no? So the answer is that there are a few non-Arabic words that are there. And Ibn Abbas claimed that the word Tur was Syriac for mountain. So you can find the word Tur in the Quran, but it was claimed that Tur was not originally an Arabic word. Right? Same way Tafiqa. Tafiqa, this word, you can find this word in the place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that Adam and Hawa alayhi salam, they start putting the leaves on their bodies, you know, when their clothes were removed in Jannah, when they ate that fruit, that forbidden fruit. So Tafiqa is root, that they started pasting. Tafiqa. So this meant to intend in Roman language. And this word came from Roman language. Same way Hudna is a Hebrew for repentance, Hudna. Sijil was a Persian for book, Sijil. Sijil al-Kutub, you'll find this word in Quran also. And then Sundus means a soft cloth in Hindi. This is a Hindi word, probably referring to Sanskrit. This is a word in Sanskrit. This was not originally in Arabic. So Mishkat, even, you know, in Surah Noor, inshallah ta'ala, you're going to read this word Mishkat. It means a shining lamp. And this is from Ethiopian language. This was not originally in Arabic language. And similarly, Siri was Greek for a small river. So his student Ikrima was also of the same opinion. All of these words, they went into the origins, and then they realized that these are not Arabic words. So this opinion led some later scholars to come forth with numerous examples of words that were claimed to be non-Arabic in origin, yet mentioned in the Quran. So As-Suyuti compiled a list of over 100 words in the Quran that were claimed to be non-Arabic in origin, and even versified these words in a poem. So you can look into the poem and you can check it out, how these words were put down in a verse by Suyuti. All these words in the Quran, for instance, some of the other words that I've mentioned here, qistas, and this means justice. Asatir, ustura, it means story. And they, where did they come from? You can find them out. It can be an assignment for you that what was the origin of these words, because they're not Arabic words, but you are going to find these words in the Quran. So some of the, you would say, portion of the definition of the Quran, it says that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? So this excludes any other speech, the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah spoke. The kalam of Allah is infinite, as the Quran says, وَلَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٌ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And if all of the trees on the earth were pens and the sea were ink, wherewith to write, with seven seas behind it to add to its supply, still the words, the kalam of Allah would not be exhausted. Verily Allah is almighty, all wise. Therefore, this part of the definition limits the Quran to the kalam that Allah revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and excludes any speech that he spoke to other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Quran is specifically the revelation sent down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because you know that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an order to Jibreel, that is also a kalam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the angels, when he speaks to the angels, that is also a kalam. But specifically the kalam that we talk about in reference to the Quran is the kalam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did with Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, this part of the definition limits the Quran to the kalam that Allah revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and excludes any other speech that he spoke other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes wa innahu latanzilu rabbil alamin nazala birruhul amin ala qalbika litakuna minal mundirin. And truly this Quran is a revelation from the Lord of the worlds, which the trustworthy spirit angel Jibreel brought down upon your heart, O Muhammad, so that you may be among the warners. The next part of the definition states that in wording and meaning, the Quran is the kalam of Allah in wording and meaning. This part of the definition affirms that the words of the Quran are from Allah, not from Jibreel or even Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As some of the innovated sects of Islam, such as the Ash'ari, allege, some people, you know what they started doing? They started putting words themselves and they started saying that this is also part of the Quran, because this is the meaning of this thing. Right? So according to some scholars, this part of the definition also excludes Hadith Qudsi. Since according to these scholars, Hadith Qudsi is only inspired in meaning while its wording is from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Quran, when you say it is the Quran, when you define it as the Quran, its words and meanings both have to come down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? If there is an ayah and there is a tafsir given by someone and the meaning is described but the words are from anyone other than Allah, it is not called the Quran. And if the meaning is there and the words are even from Prophet like in Hadith Qudsi, even that is not going to be called the Quran. The words are going to be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the meanings have to be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It cannot be that the words are from Allah and someone else starts putting other meanings in it. The way the deviant sects, they started saying that, you know, this is mentioned in the Quran and this means that, you know, they start giving them wrong meanings and they start saying that, okay, this is the part of the Quran. No, it won't be, right? Now, another part of the hadith, this definition says then it has reached us by mutawatir transmissions. A transmission is called mutawatir when it is reported by a large number of people such that they could not be all mistaken or intentionally forge a lie. So the Quran has reached us through mutawatir chains of narrations. In other words, in each generation, there are so many people who have narrated this Quran that there is no question about its authenticity. No one can say that someone forged it, someone, you know, lied about it. You know, you can't just say that. It's just not possible. So this is when you say that it is mutawatir. Last part of the definition states that it is a challenge to mankind to produce something similar to it. This is also part of the definition. That this part of the definition, what does it say? That no one can bring anything similar to the Quran. This is the miraculous nature of the Quran. Now, there are certain principles that you have to understand the concept of the kalam of Allah. There are certain principles. When would you say that this is the kalam of Allah. So the first principle is that Allah has described himself with the best and the most perfect names and attributes, right? So the names and attributes of beauty, majesty, grandeur, perfection, and excellence. In other words, all names and attributes that benefit him. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَدْعُوهُ بِهَا. And to Allah belong all the most beautiful names, so call on him with them. So in addition to affirming these names and attributes, Allah has also negated all attributes of imperfection for himself, such as sleep and tiredness, forgetfulness, error, and other attributes that do not benefit his glory. So the first thing that you're going to think when you think about the kalam of Allah, because the kalam of Allah is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing that you're going to think is that it is the best and the most perfect. The kalam of Allah is the best and the most perfect. The second principle is that Allah's name and attributes are unique. They do not resemble the attributes of his creation. So Allah says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There is nothing that is similar to him, and he is all hearer, all seer. So the second principle that you're going to consider when you think of the kalam of Allah, the speech of Allah, is that it is unique. It is not like the speech of any of the creation. It is not similar to the creation, the speech or the kalam of any of the creation. Not human beings, not any animals, not the angels, no one. The kalam of Allah is unique to only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one can have similar kalam, just like any of the other attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about which he says, laysa kamithlihi shay, right? So these two principles, when you understand them, number one, that they're the best and the most perfect, and number two, they're unique. So then you will understand the kalam of Allah is the best and most perfect, and number two, it is unique. You are going to apply this principle on the kalam of Allah. Therefore, since Allah's attributes are unique, it is not possible for mankind to understand the exact nature of Allah's names and attributes, even though it is possible to understand the concept that any name or attribute refers to. For example, the kalam of Allah will be completely unique, the best, most eloquent, the nature of which humans could never ever comprehend. وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah spoke directly to Musa. وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. And the word kalam of your Lord, the word has been fulfilled in truth and justice. So role and contribution of Ahmad al-Hanbal in this area is very, very important, because there was a big fitna at the time of Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And that fitna was that people started saying that this Quran is not the kalam of Allah. It is a makhluq. It has been created. It is a creation of Allah. So there were many different errors that could arise if this Quran had been a creation of Allah. Because like every other creation, every creation is going to end. So although many scholars have worked on this, but the main thing to understand is that creation is going to end. It is going to be destroyed at the end, you know. Every creation, let it be the sun, the moon, the humans, even the angels. So, but the kalam of Allah being an attribute, the Quran, it can never end. It's always going to be there, right? Because it is the kalam of Allah. It is an attribute of Allah. It can never diminish. So Imam Ibn Hanbal was, at this government level, he was fighting with people on knowledge base, on the basis of intellect, and he was convinced, and he tried to convince the masses also, but he was tortured. At that time, nearly all the scholars were killed. by the Khalifa of that time, because at a government level it was being said that the Quran is the creation of Allah, and these scholars were being forced to say that. But we have to be very thankful to these scholars who were imprisoned, who were tortured, but they remained firm on the belief, and they remained firm, and they carried this legacy and this truth forward for us. Now, what are the names of the Quran? The names given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. So the primary name of the Quran is the Quran. Quran is the primary name. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لَإِنَ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْدٍ ظَهِيرًا. Say, if all mankind and jinn were to gather together to produce something similar to this Quran, they would not be able to produce it even if they helped one another. Another name of the Quran is Al-Kitab. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهُ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Another beautiful name is Al-Furqan. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنَ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانَ. So another name is ذِكْر. وَذِكْرَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. All of these beautiful names are the names of this lovely, amazing book, the Quran. Okay? Another name is Tanzeel. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. And Tanzeel, innahu latanzeelu rabbil alameen. It is indeed a revelation from the Lord of the worlds. So this comes from the root word nazala. That means coming down, right? Then another word is mubarak. وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ مُصَدِّقٌ. So this is also a name of the Quran that means that it is full of barakah. This Quran is full of barakah. Now, one section was the names of the Quran. That is something different. Another is the attributes of the Quran. How does Quran describe itself? What are the different characteristics of the Quran? So let's check into that. The best and the most authentic way to describe the Quran would be to quote what it has to say about itself, right? So the number of verses that deal with the Quran are too numerous to mention here. Therefore, some of them are going to be mentioned. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِي فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. They say, in bounty of Allah and His mercy, let them rejoice. This is better than all the wealth they can amass, they can put together, right? So this is خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بُرْهَانٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُّبِينًا. O mankind, verily, there has come to you a convincing proof from your Lord. بُرْهَانٌ, the convincing proof, and we have sent down to you a manifest light. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِذَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. So another word, another characteristic is مَوْعِذَةٌ. So, O mankind, there has come to you a good advice from your Lord. Was she found? This is also healing for the sickness, for the heart. لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. Every ailment of the heart is cured by the Quran. وَهُدًا. And this is a guidance. وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And it is a mercy for the believers. This is also a characteristic of the Quran. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ الْكِتَابَ وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عِوَجًا. قَيِّمًا لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. All praise and thanks to be to Allah, who has sent down to his slave the book and has not placed it in it any crookedness. He has made it straight to give warning of a severe punishment from him and to give glad tidings to the believers. Another is وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Again, shifa, and another new name is رَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It is a mercy for the believers. اللَّهُ نَزَّلَ أَحْسَنَ الْحَدِيثِ. This is a beautiful hadith. The best of statements. كِتَابًا, a book. مُتَشَابِهًا مَثَانِي. its parts resembling each other in goodness and in truth. So you can find all of these parts in the book, Basairu Linnas, right? And so I've just collected all of these attributes together. Hudal lil muttaqin, khayrun mimma yajma'un, burhanun min rabbikum, nuran mubina, mu'izatun min rabbikum, hudan wa rahmatun lil mu'minin, lam yaj'al lahu 'iwaja, qayyiman, dhikrun mubarak, al-kitab lin nas. This is a book for all the people. So when you say that this is just for the Muslims, it's not correct, because it is for all of the people. Let them be Jews or Christians or atheists or non-Muslims or Hindus. Everyone should be reading the Quran, because it's the book for all the people. Basair lil nas, shifa'ul lima fi sudur. Every heart is going to find shifa from this book. So this is how Quran describes itself. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to do I'll just take another minute, inshallah. Let's just describe how the Quran is described in Sunnah. And this is the last part of the today's class, inshallah ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, rejoice, for verily this Quran, one part of it is in the hands of Allah, and the other part is in your hands. Therefore, hold on to it, for you will never be destroyed, not will you ever go astray after it. Umar reported that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed Allah will raise or honor people in this world and the hereafter by this book, and he will debase others by it. So the people who are not going to be honored or dishonored are going to be done because of the book, because they ignore the book. Abu Malik al-Ashari stated, the Prophet ﷺ said, the Quran is either an evidence or proof for you or against you. Ibn Amr reported, Prophet ﷺ said, the book of Allah is the rope of Allah which is dangling from the heavens down to the earth. And this hadith, you have to read yourself. When you go, you know, this is usually we say when we're taking class at the campus, then when you go back home, you have to read this hadith, but I just forgot you're actually sitting at home. So when you're done with your classes, just find some time to take out the book and read this hadith yourself, okay? And I would like you to ponder upon this hadith about the Quran, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to adorn the person who is well versed in the Quran on the day of judgment. He's going to be given a crown of glory and honor, and all of these amazing things are mentioned in the Quran and mentioned in the hadith about the Quran. So you are the people of the Quran, Ahlul Quran, right? And that is why in another hadith you will find that you guys will be known as the Ahlullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls those people the Ahl of Allah, right? So because they are studying the Quran day and night. And this is an amazing honor that is given to the people, to the students of the Quran. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you, bless your time, bless your families, and may you be of those who are inshallah ta'ala going to be rewarded in both the worlds because of the Quran. And inshallah ta'ala, we are going to take the questions if we have some time.